common.
Thank you everyone for being here. So we are delighted to welcome Anne. Anne is graduating from the École Polytechnique in Paris and then from the London School of Economics and Johns Hopkins Hospitals. She has spent 10 years in the medtech industry and now she leads an investment fund with several startups in the medical device field. So she has an invaluable knowledge about medical device. You will be free, of course, to ask any question that you want after the speech. Thank you, Anne. You can come to the stage and just start your speech. Just after the speech of Anne, I will propose a conclusion about the transition from traditional medical device to the current field of digital medical product. It will be very short.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. So my name is Anne, as previously said. And so I'm a partner at MD Start, which is a medtech seed fund and accelerator, which I'll tell you about. I'm also in charge of the medtech deal flow at a larger investment firm and more traditional venture capital firm called Sofinnova Partners, where I review the medtech opportunities. And as I'll explain, we don't look at things at the same stage from an MD Start standpoint versus from a Sofinnova standpoint. So I'm fortunate to have a relatively broad view, let's say, of what is currently being developed in the medical device industry. So I'll start with a few slides and considerations on the medical device industry as a whole. I don't want to give you a full lecture, of course, about the medical device industry. I wanted to take the perspective from an investor, or at least some financial numbers, to explain what the status is for funding such companies, how investors are viewing the field, and what the impact of this has on which companies get developed, which products reach the market, and what is important to consider strategically from the beginning for the CEOs and the management of these companies. So again, there are a number of slides with financial data. We're not going to review them in details, but they'll help me make a few points. So, as you know, the medical device industry is a very diversified market. You can find a very, very broad range of technologies, a very broad range of products, a very large spectrum of skills and people who work in that industry. But what's global and what's basically systematic for all these companies and these technologies is, generally speaking, the pathway to market access. It's a very regulated industry, and it's regulated, of course, by the regulatory approvals that you need in order to put something on the market, but also by the reimbursement process, which is now becoming an integral part of the development plan of the companies, as well as, of course, by the need for clinical validation, which is something that transcends both the regulatory and the reimbursement needs. So it's a global market today. You can't develop a company with only a particular country as a target. It's a market that has been steadily growing, and it's been growing for a number of reasons. Of course, there's increasing demand. The general, level of the quality of care has gone up. The population is aging, obviously. There are a number of new geographies and new markets that are becoming interested in providing good healthcare services, which triggers new business models or new products being developed specifically for these markets. And within that market, the European market accounts for about a third of the global market, with the French market being the second European market with above 20 billion euros. And this is basically things that I said already, but to bridge with what Jean-David will be saying towards the end of the presentation, there's definitely a shift recently with some of the IT capabilities that have made possible new products and new offers for devices or for service offers that are you know, somehow related to dealing with large amounts of data and applying this for prediction or prevention or personalized treatments with a very large number of applications that can be interesting both for diseased population as well as for healthy individuals. And this is something that is relatively new, let's say, in the field. Okay, so looking at the status of this industry funding, this is the depressing part, I'll tell you. So, you know, generally speaking, if you look at healthcare in the past 15 years, the pendulum is clearly towards biotech. You know, medtech has been kind of the poor person in the family. A large proportion of the venture capital investment has gone to biotech, which has triggered much better returns. And so, you know, the medtech industry has seen steadily dropping investments over the past 10 or 15 years. At the same time, there's increasing demand to demonstrate value. You know, 10 or 15 years ago, when you introduced a new medical device on the market, you know, you could get away with very little clinical validation, very little clinical data. You know, there are a number of examples of products that were introduced on the market basically as a marketing differentiator between one hospital and the other. And a pretty famous example of that is the Da Vinci robot, or at least the Da Vinci robot in the early years. Was introduced on the market with very little clinical data. So there's basically a need to increase the level of validation, clinical validation, health economic validation of these products. And at the same time, the VC funding is getting concentrated into fewer hands, with fewer VCs investing in medtech. And as a consequence, a large number of startup companies in the field struggle to raise cash. However, when you look at the large players in the industry, when you look at the Medtronics, the J&Js of the world, they still rely on external growth and startup company acquisitions to develop their product offering. They do very, very little internal R&D, or at least, you know, within R&D, they do mostly D. They don't do the initial research anymore, or they haven't been doing it for many years. So they're still looking for acquisition targets. But they acquire companies at later stage, after the companies have, of course, been de-risked, usually from a technological standpoint, but more and more after they have been de-risked from a regulatory standpoint and even from a reimbursement standpoint, which delays the time at which you can pretend to an acquisition and increases the need for finding capital and sustaining your own growth until that happens. Another thing that's pretty interesting is that, you know, and this is more recent, you know, in the last, 3 to 4 years, is that, you know, the CE mark and the FDA path are becoming more even. During many years, the FDA was a very high bar. The CE mark was relatively easy. The regulations have changed. The CE mark is now more stringent. And the FDA, on the other hand, is, let's say, more reactive and also more prone to dialogue than before. So you can engage in a discussion with the FDA very early in your development, which was not the case before, and which generates questions as to, okay, where should I do my clinical validation now? You know, is it necessarily going to be in Europe as it was in the past, or is there an opportunity to get clinical data in the US and to pursue both regulatory approvals at the same time? Okay, medtech investments overview. Okay, just to say that it has been steadily going down. And as we said, you know, some of these larger companies might have caused the issue because they acquire companies later than before. What's even more interesting is if you look at the medtech investments by geography, what you're going to see is that for early stage medtech companies, there's a complete drought of funding in the US. There's almost no venture capital firm doing early stage, you know, traditional medical device investments in the US. And there are still a number of VC firms in Europe doing seed and Series A rounds, which means that, relatively speaking, it used to be much easier to find capital in the US. Now it's not the case anymore. And for instance, at Sofinnova and at MD Start, the number one provider in our deal flow in terms of country is the US. We're seeing now a lot of companies and a lot of technologies and inventors from the US looking for money in Europe because they can't find any in the US. Which for us, as a result, is pretty good because we're seeing everything and the overall quality of the deal flow increases. But it's, you know, it's an issue for these companies to find find capital. Okay, the number of investment rounds is also dropping, which means that fewer companies get more money, but a larger number of companies have a struggle going to the next stage. However, you know, you can get creative with funding, and there's not only the venture capital industry. If you look at non-VC funding rounds, it's been, let's say, going up, regularly. So with a number of mechanisms, you can use, of course, large corporate investments. You know, these large companies I was mentioning earlier tend to invest in companies during their development stage without acquiring them, but at least, you know, they invest and they follow your development up to a maturity level where you're now a good target for acquisition. We have this in two of our MD Start companies. We have large corporates who have put some money at the Series A round. And then, of course, using debt as a way to fund your company, which is a good idea when you're on a commercial ramp-up, because, of course, debt needs to be reimbursed, and debt is reimbursed before any other money. So when you start raising debt, you need to make sure that you're going to have revenue to reimburse it. And then, in the US, you have new funding models with some of the payers, so Kaiser and United Healthcare, now having investment funds and now searching for medtech innovation themselves. Okay, now medtech exits. So it's a bit, hard to draw conclusions from this graph, but what we've seen in the recent years is generally a consolidation of the industry with what we call these mega deals, Medtronic and Covidien, etc. So very, very large consolidation deals, which are generally meant for tax reasons, tax inversions. Not necessarily for very interesting strategic reasons, but some of these deals have bumped up the number of exits and the amount of these exits, but it's just an artifact. If you look at the regular sized deals, the average deal value is $400 million, which is very significant. But again, these deals now happen when the companies are commercial, when they have products in the market, and not only as a technological at a technological stage. In terms of sector, which sector is interesting, or of course all sectors are interesting, but which sector is trendy? What has seen a lot of interest, at least from the financing industry? So there has been a lot of activity in the orthopedic sector, a lot of consolidation, because I don't know if you're familiar with orthopedics, but it's a very cash-intensive industry, because basically when you come in an orthopedics case, you come with your whole tray of like screws and implants and stuff, and the surgeon is going to pick what he needs during the procedure. But basically, you have a very, very significant inventory in the operating room as the surgeon performs the procedure, and also the sales reps very often need to be in the room to actually help manage that inventory. So it's an industry in which you need a lot of cash to get commercial. And as a result, you know, a lot of the players in the orthopedic sector have been just merging to scale up. There has been a rush recently in robotic surgery with a number of acquisitions and deals with different clinical rationale, you know, but the overall promise, let's say, is to reduce recovery times for the patient and to reduce also fatigue from a surgeon perspective. And in the robotic surgery space, there was a very nice deal from a French company over the past summer. The company is called MedTech, and it was acquired by Zimmer for 150 million euros. So that is something we can be proud of. And for now, the company, or at least the team, is staying in Montpellier. So that's relatively good. Okay, what else? I'm just looking at the other color, yeah. Of course, cardiac procedures and cardiac companies have always been very very hot in the field. You know, about 10 years ago, the shift started from cardiac surgery, open cardiac surgery, to endovascular procedures, minimally invasive cardiac procedures, what is called transcatheter cardiac procedures. And so the transcatheter field started with the development of aortic valve replacement products and technologies. Now that this is becoming, you know, a standard of care, the efforts have shifted to another heart valve, which is called the mitral valve. And just 2 years ago, all the mitral valve companies were acquired over the summer, literally in 3 months. There was, you know, one acquisition which triggered a second one and a third one, and you know, literally over a few weeks, everyone did his own shopping, and that is also interesting because it contradicts what I just told you about companies being acquired later. You know, you have these effects, these trends. And for mitral valves, one of the companies was acquired. They had, I don't know, six patients under their belt. They were pretty far from the market. And then all of a sudden, all the other large players said, hey, I have to have a play in the mitral valve space as well. And so all the companies got acquired with even less clinical experience. And now everybody is realizing that it's not going to be that easy to bring these mitral valve products to the market, and that it's going to take years. But, you know, for the CEOs of these companies, it was a pretty good deal. With very, very significant numbers if you look at these valuations. So if we look at the acquirers in the field, of course, these large, very large deals have reduced the number of acquirers. You know, you used to have Medtronic and Covidien competing on, you know, sort of the same space. Well, now it's one single company, so there's one fewer acquirer. If you look at the acquirers, they're in number far fewer than what you have in the pharma industry. Their market cap is also much lower, meaning that they have just less money to acquire medtech companies. However, we're seeing a number of new acquirers into the mix with digital health, you know, rising. So some of the new acquirers, you know, such as, I don't know, Google, Samsung, which were never thought to be medtech players or acquirers in the past, now have healthcare divisions and are now, you know, for some deals, seriously considered as potential acquirers. Where does, you know, the innovation come from? And is there a question? No, okay. So this is just an excerpt from our deal flow at MD Start or Sophie Nova. I can't remember which one, but it's actually pretty much the same. So as I was telling you, you know, a very large proportion of the deal flow comes from the US now, or the US and Canada. Israel has always been a very, you know, strong inventor in the medtech field. And where is France? Yeah, France is here, 13%. So France is absolutely not ridiculous. We're seeing a lot of inventions from France. There are a lot of startup companies from France, and that's good. And it's it's good and it's needed. Both at Sophie Nova and at MD Start, for instance, we have BPI France as one of our investors, because we, of course, as anyone, raise funds and spend a lot of time raising funds in order to be able to invest them as well. And having BPI France as one of our investors, we have a mandate to find French companies and French technologies and invest in them. Or at MD Start, you know, we find technologies and we develop companies around them. We have a mandate to create, to incept these companies in France, and that is because of or thanks to BPI. So the fact that there's a good inventivity in France is something important for us. In terms of sector, CV stands for cardiovascular. So cardiovascular is always going to be, the largest chunk, I think, and the place where you can find most most money, most inventions. Orthopedics, neuro, ophthalmology, surgery are very strong providers of new technologies in the medtech field. Okay. And I'm happy to share these slides later if you want. Okay, so given that, how do we build a great medtech company? So as we said, the path is narrower than in biopharma. On the other side, the development process and the time to market is shorter than what you have in biopharma. So, you need to take advantage of that. From an inventor and an early investor standpoint, it's important to own large stakes of the companies, because you need to recognize that you're going to need to raise capital over and over to get to the market and to sustain your development yourself until you either get profitable or get acquired. And what's important is you need to know all the alternative funding sources. Going to knock on the door of the VCs is usually not enough anymore. So knowing the corporate players from the very beginning, knowing some of the large family office, knowing in which cases you can use debt for financing is very important. At MD Start, we have a philosophy that in order to build great medtech companies, the easiest way is just to create them. But it's just to say that if you take things very very early and you develop them yourself, you're probably in a better place, at least from when you put your own money in, than when you meet a company that has already been partly developed. And then there are a number of places that help the development of medtech companies, or that spin out technologies that can become companies. So of course, incubator, tech transfer offices, there are a lot of things coming out of hospitals. You can source for new ideas at conferences, and then we have a great ecosystem in France with grants, which can help develop your companies in a non-dilutive way, and which are very, very helpful. Okay, so now new models for developing medtech companies, and specifically MD Start. So MD Start was created in 2009-2010, based on a number of things. The first one is if you look at the Medtronic product portfolio, 80% of the products were invented in Europe. I know this only because the guy who sits on my board from Medtronic, did this exercise and did this exercise to convince his own management that they needed to invest in our structure. But a very large part of the inventions in the medical device field originate from Europe. So we're sitting basically in a geography where there's a lot of stuff in the hospitals, and we need to basically get this stuff out and transform it into businesses. So a firm like Sophie Nova, for instance, 10 years ago was seeing a lot of physicians knocking on their door. And saying, hey, I have this great invention, and will you fund it? And that was an issue for Sophie Nova, because the inventions were great, but they couldn't just put the money in. These inventors, they needed, of course, the money, but they needed a lot of operational help, they needed the expertise, and they needed basically, you know, a team and a structure to develop these concepts into companies that would then be mature enough to be eligible for traditional venture capital money. So Sofinova had a number of these projects coming directly from physicians and researchers. Companies such as Medtronic, as we said, were incapable of helping these inventors develop these devices. They'd rather buy something $400 million once it's perfectly developed and de-risked, rather than buying it for one-tenth the price, but much earlier. And then one of my partners at MD Start had a contract manufacturing company, so a third-party company for development of medical devices. And he was also seeing a lot of physicians knocking on his door and saying, hey, I have this great concept for a new medical device. Can you make a prototype for me? And he had another issue, which was that, of course, these inventors didn't have money to pay for the prototypes, but they also didn't have the skills to specify the prototypes correctly from a technical standpoint, so he wasn't sure what to build. So based on all that, we created MD Start, which is, basically a small fund where we have the luxury of creating multiple companies, and where we look for inventors and technologies, and then we bridge the gap between these inventors and companies at a stage where they can go see traditional venture capital firms and raise more money to sustain their development. So we actively operate the companies we create. We define ourselves as entrepreneurs more than investors. We develop very early technologies. Usually we see things before there's any patent, of course before there's any prototype, and before there's any proof that it's gonna work. So you probably cannot make it more risky. And we create companies that probably would not have existed. We see that when, sometimes we take a while to answer to an inventor because we're evaluating a lot of things and we just, couldn't get back to the person in time. These inventions, they're not going away. Because these physicians who have these great inventions, they're stuck, They have a daily job as a clinician. They want to see their invention get to the market, but they don't have the skills, they don't have the money. So when we develop these projects, often we recognize that these companies we create would probably not have existed without us, which is pretty good because we're not competing, with any of the seed funds or with any of the other incubator models in our field. So we have created to date 5 companies in very, very different fields. The first one is called APD. It's based in Lyon. It develops a device used for critical care, where we try to detect very early signs of sepsis. And so this company now has CE mark. It has its own management. They're doing a larger clinical study for efficacy purposes. But they live their own life out of incubation at MD Start. CoreWave is our second company. It's in the field of cardiovascular pumps. It's a new pump that is meant to solve some of the complications of the current heart pumps. So this is a very ambitious project. It's currently getting ready for chronic animals. So you see that the path to market is still long for this one, but it's working really well. They have raised first round of funding after they came out of MD Start, and then recently, a few months ago, a very significant second round of funding with about $18 million, which should get them to first in man. Lymphflow is our third company. It's a company in the field of peripheral vascular applications, where we're basically revascularizing the foot of patients who have severe critical limb ischemia and who are at risk of getting amputated. So this company, the product also has CE mark. We have actually sold our first units, believe it or not, early this year on LymphFlow. We're working on getting FDA approval. And so again, this is a company that is out of incubation at MD Start. It has its own CEO, its own team now, and it's living its own life. Safeheal is a company that is currently being incubated. It's in the field of colorectal surgery. And we're about to get into patients on this one with the goal of getting a CE mark and FDA clearance, let's say, a year from now. And then Precardia is the latest company we've created in the field of heart failure, acute heart failure. And on this one, which we have just incepted, we'll be doing some preclinical work in the next few months. And we're looking at other projects which could become our next companies. Okay, I'm not going to bore you with that, but okay, we're basically looking for disruptive technologies, not incremental products, because we recognize that the companies we create need to be able to survive as standalone companies. So they need to be very ambitious, basically, to raise large amounts of funding. We focus on projects where we can get to first-in-man relatively quickly. And of course, I just showed you CoreWave, which is the perfect counterexample. But generally speaking, we try to find projects where we can prove the concept in patients relatively quickly. And then we're very careful also about making sure that our offers or our companies fit in the adoption landscape. We want to make sure that there's going to be, of course, a clinical need, but also that the procedures or the products we develop are going to be adopted in clinical routine, meaning that the patient workflow makes sense. So we talk to a lot of the industry players, of the large medtech players, to make sure that what we develop makes sense for them down the road if they want to have it in their portfolio, and makes sense for the clinicians. So I told you we're a team of entrepreneurs. So these are my two partners who have a long history of medtech entrepreneurship. And then, of course, we don't pick our projects by ourselves. We have a pretty strong advisory board, which is very challenging. As I said, they ask us to do a lot of homework before we pick a company or a project to develop, but that's good. We get a lot of our deal flow. We get about 200 submissions every year from physicians, and a large part of that comes directly through our website, which you're welcome to visit. And of course, we didn't invent what we do. This type of model exists in the U.S. Our absolute dream is to look like something called the Foundry. The Foundry is a very similar model to MD Start, except that they have been so successful developing companies and selling them to Medtronic, mostly, that now they're able to go see people and say, hey, we're going to create our next company. We don't know what it's going to be about. So we do pretty much the same thing. We're going to give this company a name, which is now a number. So the Foundry, they have this company called 12, 13, 14. So now they're at, number 16 or something. And they just say that, and they raise $3 million, and then they incubate it, and then they figure out what the project is going to be later. Of course, you can do that when out of your 15 past companies, you've sold 14. So we're not there yet. We took the you know, we chose to raise, let's say, a larger envelope of money to do four companies at a time, which takes a lot of effort. But at least we don't have to go back and beg for money for every company because we wouldn't be able to do it as the foundry. Coridia is another example of a similar structure in the US. New types of companies, and Jean-David will touch on this later. Of course, the digital health market has been booming. This is something that we need to get familiar with, and frankly, the venture capital scene, especially the European venture capital scene, is not very good at this at this point. You know, they still have a very hard time evaluating the risk profile for these companies. It's pretty different in the US from that perspective. When I told you that, you know, for traditional medtech, medical devices, the investments for early stage companies are no more in Europe. For digital health, it's the other way around because European VCs don't understand this field very well yet, to say the least. But we have a number of great examples of such companies here in the room or in Paris or in France. So Cardiologs being one of them. FeedMe being another one, Rhythm, of course, and then this is another one that we reviewed recently at Sofinnova. So these are new opportunities that need to be much better assessed, at least from people like us at MD Start, because we don't know how to develop such projects within MD Start, let's say. You know, we're good at mechanics, we're good at electronics, we're good at hardware stuff, but we just don't have the skills to develop software or IT products. However, what we're good at is we know what it takes to develop these things and put them on the market. Because it's, you know, pretty much the same, regulatory clearances, clinical evidence, reimbursement. We know that it's immensely complicated. This is the French pathway. So we're still happy to help some of these companies get there. And this is just my last slide with a few takeaways. So things are going to take longer and more money than you would think. So you need to get ready for that. Integrate, of course, the regulatory aspect from the very beginning. Establishing your quality system is one of the, you know, one of the must-haves. Anticipating the need for clinical data very early on. Being creative, and you know, within these regulations, you can be creative. You can be creative in how you demonstrate your regulatory claims. You can be creative in your clinical study design. You can be creative in the predicate devices that you use as comparables. So you know, you need to think outside the box. The other thing is, from a regulatory standpoint, you know, always start small, and then add up additional claims. That's pretty important. A lot of companies want to, you know, get it right from the first time, but you have to recognize that regulatory filings are going to be permanent. So you're always going to have a chance to add more data and to claim more things, and to make then your marketing stronger. So you know, start getting approval for relatively limited things, and then you'll make your case stronger and you'll get additional regulatory approvals. Talking to the regulatory agencies is something you're gonna do all the time. And then validate your business model while you're doing all this. So you know, you can just, I think one of the good things about digital health is it's forcing people in medtech think from the perspective that there can be multiple business models and that you have an opportunity to try them. And this is very, you know, new for medtech people. I mean, in medtech in the past, you used to sell a box and you would say, you know, when you sold two boxes, you would have twice the money coming in, and it was very, very simple. I think this whole field of digital health is, you know, radically changing the business model approach. And forcing people to think about it earlier and to test it during the development stages, which is making it, you know, very interesting for the veterans of the industry, let's say. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anne. So it's almost finished. I will just make a small transition and conclusion. Anne has presented now, just has presented the medical device industry, which is a mature industry. But you know that there is another close or similar industry just besides the medical device industry, which is the digital medical product industry. So I'm just going to tell you a few words about it, and then you will be able to ask your questions to Anne. So are you developing a medical device or not? Okay. So you know that the medical industry and the digital industry are very different from each other. The medical industry on the left side is highly regulated because it's about health of people, whereas the digital industry is not regulated or loosely regulated. The medical industry, as Anne just said, it's very cash intensive. It's very expensive to invent a medical device, whereas it's not very expensive to develop a smartphone application or a software. It's expensive, of course, but much less expensive. The cycles are very different. For a drug, it's from 7 to 11 years, and from a medical device, it's from 3 to 7 years from the invention to the market, whereas it's very short because you need to iterate in part for the digital industry. The risk is not the same. The healthcare industry is characterized by the technical risk. That means you invent a great product, but for any reason that you cannot identify or cannot anticipate, it fails, it doesn't work. It's not safe or not effective. Whereas the digital industry is characterized by a commercial risk. In the end, you will always succeed in making the software of the smartphone application, but maybe nobody will use it and you will not make money with it. And then the protection is not the same because the medical industry helps you with the intellectual property that protects you against the competition. There is very less room much less room for intellectual property in the digital field, but the protection often comes from the network effects. So very different industry, that's why it's still an immature field, the medical digital industry. It's at least to my opinion. So the US regulation about the medical device, it's been 40 years since the FDA has the authority to oversight the medical device field, and there is a specific divisions in the FDA which takes care about that. And you have risk-based classification in three classes. The risk one is for safest device, like those to depress tongue, for example. Okay, it's very safe, so very easy, very inexpensive to develop, and very easy to get approval. The class two device is for moderate risk or well understood risk. For instance, physiology monitoring comes into that field. And then the risk three is the most risky device. It's close to drug regulation, like for instance, pacemakers. So what you have to know now is that you have, for the majority of class two and for all class three devices, two possibilities to get approval: the 510K and the pre-market approval. They are very different because the 510K is built upon the historical precedent. That means that you need to find a predicate, that means another product pre-existing to yours that was already invented, that is already on the market, and to get approval, you need to show that you have a substantial equivalence as compared with him. So you need to find something which resembles to your product, and then if you perform a trial that demonstrates the substantial equivalence, it's okay for you. But there is the other pathway, the pre-market approval, which is much more stringent because it's close to a drug approval, and you have to generate evidence of safety and efficacy. And of course, it's at least from the financial standpoint, an obstacle to innovation, because if you invent something new, there is no predicate. If it's totally innovative, you cannot find something which resembles to you. So you have, you cannot find a predicate, so you can have, you cannot use the easiest pathway for approval, so you have to make a bigger clinical trials, longer, with much more stringency aspects, and it will be more difficult and more expensive. So it's at least more difficult to innovate with that respect. So what about digital products? And for digital products, the FDA issued a guidance like 6 years ago, and it's quite clear for this. For the general wellness products, it's not regulated for two reasons. The first one, it's not possible because there are thousands of products that claim a benefit on wellness. And the second one is that the FDA judged that there were not dangerous products, so it was not a need to regulate them. But if you have a claim of a health benefit, or if you carry a certain level of risk, you will be regulated under the FDA oversight. And the devil is in the details. So for instance, for the claim, if you say that you are going to treat depression, it's medical, it's regulated, you have to make clinical study to generate sufficient evidence and so forth. But if you say that you improve mood, it's vague and you might not be regulated. For the risk, which is the second criteria for being regulated by the FDA, the question that you have to ask yourself is, what will happen if my product fails? If the result, if the finding is not accurate? And it can be risky or it can be not risky. For instance, if you have a connected device that tells you how long did you run when you made your footing on the Sunday morning, if it's inaccurate, it doesn't threaten your life. But if it's something for our patients with cardiac failure, it can be dangerous. So this is the question that you need to know in advance before dealing with the regulatory issue. So the European regulation, as Anne said, is getting closer to the FDA regulation, but you have the same challenges inherent to the digital products, for example, the human testing, which is like you need to be creative for the human testing because there is a poor historical track of clinical studies with digital products. For instance, you know what the sham procedure is? The sham procedure is the fact that if you want to compare your product with nothing, you cannot do it with nothing. You have to use like a kind of placebo. But people must not know that they used the placebo. Otherwise, they can be influenced in the results. So you have to use sham procedure that simulate the real procedure. But for a digital application, it's not possible because people know they use them. The standard of manufacture also are quite difficult, and the updates of your product, it's difficult because once you get an approval, if you want to perform an update, which is very frequent in the digital industry, you have to tell it to the regulator. So each time it triggers a new process of getting approval, and this is not mature. We don't know how to deal with that. But the regulator, they don't know either how to deal with that. Last slide on France. So the ANSM, Agence Nationale de Sécurité du Médicament et des Produits de Santé, is in charge of the regulation. And on the website, it's clearly stated that not all software and not all mobile application must be regulated, because they are not all of the medical device, and most of them are not, of course. The destination, it means the medical use or not, is defined by the inventor, by the company, and if it is intended for medical use, it is by definition a medical device. A software which is associated with a medical device, as those of Anne, for instance, are considered as medical device also. But then the risk in itself is not a criteria. And some products are not medical devices, like software for administrative management, like the electronic health record, dossier médical, not medical device. The telemedicine companies, not medical devices. And the logiciel de prescription, not medical device also. So there is no general rule. It's often determined on a case-by-case basis. Now the take-home messages. So you have to wonder about the regulatory issue very early in your development. You have to get some advice because most of the time you are not experts of the regulatory aspects, which is quite technical and quite complex. So you have to seek advice from the good people and sometimes from many people about the regulatory standards that you need to fill in because it will influence all your development, all the preclinical data, the clinical data, and quality data that you have to exhibit with respect to the regulators, so has to be approved and to be allowed to market your product. The regulators will be more likely to be concerned with risk. The ANSM doesn't care very much about whether your product is effective, whether it changes life, but they are obsessed with safety. You have heard that in France we had some regulatory scandals with respect to safety with drugs and also with devices. So they are obsessed with that. So you have to show, at least to the regulator, that the product is safe, and if it fails, it is not a threat to the health of people that use them. But the assessors and the payers will be more concerned with efficacy because since they will be likely to reimburse your product, you have to show them that it will increase the life of the healthcare, the health state of people that will use them. So it's difficult to reconcile those two objectives. And ideally, you should, at an early stage, it's not always possible, but you should think about it. You should, at an early stage, think about the fact that you would maybe prefer to generate data that will both show the safety of the product and its efficacy or its relative efficacy, I mean the added value as compared to the standard of care. Thank you.
I'd like to know if MDSTAAT is currently looking for new projects.
Yes, we have raised money to create 4 new companies and we have created 2 companies to date.
In which fields?
One of them in the colorectal surgery, and the second one is in the field of cardiovascular. We're actively searching for new stuff.
Thank you for your speech. I would like to know how do you integrate the legal part in your work? Do you work with lawyers, or do you have already legal partners?
For company inception or financing, or which part?
For the beginning of the company, if we have any needs of approvals, or during the long term when we need, as in the US FDA approval or things like that.
Okay. So for regulatory purposes, we don't work with lawyers. We work with consultants, regulatory consultants, or with lobbyists sometimes for reimbursement. For legal matters, so each company is a bit different depending on who the inventor is, on where the inventor is from, because it's pretty different if they work in private practice versus if they work for a public institution. So if they work in private practice, usually they own the patents. If they work for a public institution, we have to deal with a tech transfer office. Every deal is different. Sometimes it's based on a patent license with royalties. Sometimes there's an upfront payment to get the patent license. Sometimes the deal is based on giving equity to the inventor or to the inventors. So we're pretty flexible in the way we do it, depending on who we have in front of us and what their requirements are. We're open to any deal structure. We typically negotiate the terms ourselves, and then when it comes to, you know, writing the shareholders agreement or the license agreement, we get a lawyer in. Yeah, and we have lawyers who are used to working with medtech startups, so they know how to do it. Yeah.
Are you allowed to invest in companies outside Europe?
So from an ND start standpoint, we're not allowed to invest in companies. We are allowed to invest in projects and technologies, provided we create the companies, and we have to create the companies in France. But the technology can come from anywhere. The latest company we created, Precardia, is an invention that is out of Tufts University in Boston, but we created the company in France. So MDStart is very specific in the fact that we're not looking for companies, we're looking for projects and inventors. If you're talking about Sofinnova, yes, of course, we're able to invest in companies outside of France. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much. Que la famille.